You are Lord of all. There is no one, there is nothing greater than you, Lord Jesus. Lord, I ask you now to take your word, to open our hearts, our minds to your word. Lord, I ask you to draw us to your side. Bring healing to our lives, Father God, and bring healing to our lands in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to thank our worship team. It's one thing to lead worship, but it's another thing to get people into worship. And man, that's what's going on. It's awesome. Amen. If you have your Bibles, we're going to start in Matthew chapter 28. We're going to start with a short text, and I still haven't gotten away from Easter yet, if that's okay with you. I just think it's wrong to try one Sunday for Easter and then move on. And so we're going to read the Great Commission today. The title is All, Everything, and Always. If you're reading an old King James Version Bible, it could just be All and Always, and you'll see why. But the point is, we're going to study this text. And so I'm going to read Matthew chapter 28. It's the Great Commission. We're very familiar with it, and I pray that the Lord opens our mind to his word today. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Father, I ask you to shed light on your word and on your text today. In Jesus' name, amen. The first point is all authority. Jesus says, "I have all authority." Verse 16 says the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had told them. And then the next verse says, when they saw him, they worshiped him. Your first point, the disciples obey and worship Jesus. If you obey someone and if you worship them, they have authority. Would you agree? Ooh, that was weak. That was weak, yeah. We'll wake up. We got time. Get some of that chili in you, you'll shout. The disciples obey and worship Jesus. Now, it amazes me in that text, it still says, but some doubt. Do you know that in every text we've read over the last 3 weeks, it says in there, but some doubt. If you have doubt in your life today, I pray that God expunges it like a virus from you and drives it out of this place so you can believe God's word. It's getting better. The next point, Jesus has all authority in heaven and on earth. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Not some, not a little, not authority here, not authority there, but all authority. Now, the reason I believe it says that is because Jesus has been raised up from the dead. This has to do with the resurrection from the dead. When Jesus was walking on this earth and he was preaching and teaching, it says that the people loved him and they noticed that he taught with authority and not like the Pharisees. So they knew he had some authority. But here's the deal. Jesus said, "I am the Son of God. You will see me seated at the right hand of the Father." And he said, "I will suffer and die, and I will be raised on the third day." So when Jesus came out of the grave and he was raised up from the dead, now he is who he says he is. He's being taken up into heaven here when we read the text. And that proves that Jesus is who he's been saying he is. And he raises up from the grave. Therefore, he says, all authority has been given to me. If you went uptown today and if you took a poll and you said, who has all the authority, you would get a whole bunch of answers. But this morning, it's my prayer that you'll see because of the resurrection, Jesus has all authority. He says it, and it's true. The next point, death defeats men, women, and children. Jesus has been raised up from the dead, and he says, all authority has been given to me. He has overcome death, hell, and the grave. And as I was studying this, I realized that I have done funerals for little infants that never knew light. And the parents will call and they'll say, we need you to do a service. We need you to come. I've done service for a 4-year-old, for an 11-year-old, 12-year-old, a 13-year-old. I've done funerals for people younger than me now. And I pray you can see the point. Death defeats men, women, and children. And your next point, sin is the cause of death. Adam was in the garden. God said to Adam, hey, multiply and subdue the earth. And Adam was in the garden of Eden, and God trusted him, and he gave him authority. And do you know, this had to be a great day in creation. God brought all the animals to Adam, and he named them. Just think about that for a minute. You know, that's got to be a giraffe. That has to be an elephant. You know, that is a poodle. I knew that would wake somebody up. But he had authority and he was there. But sin is the cause of death. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I'm going to read to you verses 54 to the end of the chapter. It says, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin. Please don't miss this, church. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And if I could add, because he has all the authority. Sin causes death. If you're following in your outline, Adam lost authority in the Garden of Eden. God says, this is all yours, Adam. Adam, there's only one thing you can't do. Don't eat from that tree. And he had all the authority, and here comes the devil, and he says, did God really say? Anytime you hear a voice in your head that says, did God really say? I hope you recognize that's not from God. And that's how the enemy tricked Eve, and he said, did God really say? And he talked Eve into eating, and she talked Adam into eating, and they lost authority in the garden. The enemy had no say, no call here on earth until Adam fell. Death defeated Adam. If you read the text, if you read those first three chapters of Genesis, what you're going to see is after Adam and Eve sin, then God comes in with the curse before he banishes them, and he says, now you will die, and he says, you will sweat. By the sweat of your brow, you'll bring forth your food, and weeds came into being. He says, you're going to have to weed and cultivate now. For every farmer, we have to talk to Adam. And that's the effect of sin, and he lost it. Death defeated Adam is your next point. Look at the next one. Jesus defeated death. And when under the heading of all authority, Jesus has all authority, it's because death could not hold him. The grave could not keep him. He defeated it. We're going to go back to 1 Corinthians now. We're going to start in verse 20. And I'm going to read, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. It starts and it carries on from here. Paul says, if there's no resurrection from the dead, we're all dead in our sin. But then he comes and he says, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. But each in his own turn, Christ the first fruits, then we, or when he comes, those who belong to him. See, I was all excited. That's us, folks. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom of God the Father, or to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion and authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for he has put everything under his feet. Now, when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. And when he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. The title of one of the songs we were singing, God is all in all. It's so important today that you understand that Jesus came and died on the cross and rose from the dead, and he has all authority. Look at your next point. Lack of faith distorts authority in the world. When I was in high school, my religion teacher gave me an assignment. And he said, you have to write a creation story, but you can't use the one in the Bible. I was a farmer. I thought God created every Holstein cow I own. I thought he put every spot on them exactly like the spot is. I thought I was created by God. I didn't have a clue what I was supposed to write on that piece of paper. My brother-in-law came to me and I said, I don't get this. I said, what am I supposed to write down? I don't know any other story here. And he said to me, write this. Write that a cell crawled out of the water. He hooked up with another cell and it became a man. I looked at him and I said, you are crazy. And I can remember him shouting at me and going, do you want to pass the class or not? And you know what? That day I should have said, no, I want to flunk. Because I knew everything I needed to know. I knew I was created by God. Now, hear the point again. Lack of faith distorts authority in the world. If you don't believe God created Adam, and if you don't believe that Adam and Eve sinned, and if you don't believe in sin, why would you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior? And why would he have to die on the cross then? And folks, the world is teaching us, trying to teach us, and trying to teach your children and your grandchildren that we weren't created, that there is no creation, that Adam did not exist like the Word of God says, and therefore they can discredit Jesus in the New Testament, and we have this faithless society, and authority has been distorted and messed up. Look at your next point. Every human ruler will die and be judged. Wow. The leader of Russia will die and be judged. The leader of Iran will die one day, and he will be judged by God. China's leader, North Korea's leader, will die and they will be judged by God. Right now, they think that they have all this authority. But Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And before we move from this point, I'm going to put it in there again. It's right there in your notes. Jesus has all authority, not some authority, not a little authority. He has all the authority. From there, we move on to all nations. It says in verse 19, go into all nations. If I could just tell you what it doesn't say go into all nations except for China. It doesn't say go into all nations except for Turkey or Iran or Iraq. Don't go there. It could be dangerous. Jesus didn't say that. He said to his disciples, go into all nations. I want you to know, go is not a suggestion. Jesus is not saying to his church, you know, if you feel like it, if you have the money, if the door opens for you, then go and preach. He is not saying that. He's commanding his disciples and he's commanding us, go. In a sense, he's saying, you can't sit still and be quiet. And the excuses are unbelievable. Well, I don't know Scripture that well. I'm kind of a shy person, you know. I'm not all that relational. You know, I don't have a very loud voice. Yeah, if the Packers win the Super Bowl, your voice will get so loud they won't be able to quiet you. And it's a command from God. Go! I love wearing my Bikers for Christ vest. It gets me into more conversations. And I was at Walmart the other day, and I'm walking in, and a lady comes up behind me, and she says, hey, that Bikers for Christ, that's different than CMA, Christian Motorcycle Association. And I said, yeah, it's a little different, but I said, we both have the same founder. And she went, really, the same guy founded them both? And I said, yeah, Jesus. And she stopped and she said, that was really a good answer. And I wanted to tell her my boss would fire me if I didn't say that. But it's not hard. It's not difficult if you're ready. Are you ready to go and to be a witness and to make disciples? The gospel works and is needed in all nations. If you bring the Word of God, if you bring Jesus Christ into any society, it will change because people will die to themselves, they will live for Christ, and it will make things better. And it's needed everywhere. So he says, go into all nations, not some nations, all nations. We have believed this at Mount Zion for as long as I've been here and before I was here. We used to have two little ladies. We used to have Joan Johnson and Carol Parshall, and they used to come to this church a long, long time ago. And I can remember them standing up here, and they said, shut the mics off. Don't record us when we say this. But at that time, they were smuggling Bibles into Cuba. These frail little ladies, you'd look at them and go, oh, they're harmless. And they were bringing Bibles into Cuba. This is 20-some years ago. And now we're going to open up, aren't we? I wonder if they'll let missionaries in. That's going to be very interesting to see what happens, isn't it? Because we're going to have missionaries ready to go. We support missionaries all over the world in countries that are dangerous. And right now, they need your prayers, church, because they're not sure if they can stay, if they'll be safe. They can't get their visas renewed. I'm reading letters coming back from them, and we need to be on our knees in prayer for them because they have gone to all nations, and we are supporting them. Before you leave today, when you walk out here and back, we have teenagers who are going to spend their summer going out to different nations, and they're going to witness, and they're going to worship. And you know what it's going to do? It's going to change their life forever. They're going to come back here, and parents are going to just love it because they are going to find out there's more to this world than just what they're thinking about doing. That God has a plan for them, and he's going to take them. And so please support them, talk to them, pray for them. Under the all heading, he says, go baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And I have to tell you, people all the time are confused by the Trinity. They don't totally understand, and they'll say, well, I understand Jesus, but I don't understand the Father and the Holy Spirit. He really baffles me. Folks, if you get one, you get all. You know, Thomas says, hey, Jesus, show us the Father. That's good enough. He says, have I been with you so long, Thomas, and you still don't know me? And you can't take part of God. You have to take all of God. Go into all nations, but go with all of him, everything he has for you. It is my prayer this morning. You'll say, hey, God, give me whatever you want. I want to take it. I need it. The presence of God is powerful. Turn to your neighbor and say, that was the easy part of the message. Because from here out, it gets tough. But you have to test this morning if I'm preaching what the Word of God says, if I'm letting the Word of God speak, or if I'm making it up, okay? Here it is, everything. Disciples must teach obedience to all Jesus' commands. Please hear what it says. It says, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. If you have a King James Version, it says, all I have commanded you. Did you notice that Jesus doesn't say, these are his words, he doesn't say, you have to obey the things you like. He doesn't say, you must obey and you must teach the things you understand. He doesn't say that. He says, you have to teach everything. Teach them to obey everything that I have commanded you. Every time I think about Mount Zion Christian School, I think about training young men and young women up to believe what Jesus has taught. I think about teaching them how to read and how to write and how to do their math and teaching them geography and history, but putting Jesus in it because he has all the authority. And when you try to teach people and you take Jesus out of it, you cannot keep his command. When he says, teaching them to obey everything. It's why there's Mount Zion Christian School. It's why there's Faith Christian School. It's why we want to teach our young people and keep Jesus in their life, in the center of their life, as all authority. If you're witnessing, you can't tell somebody part of the gospel. Sometimes it's a timing issue. Sometimes they are not quite ready to hear everything that they're doing right and everything that they're doing wrong. But eventually you have to tell the truth and you have to put it on God. You have to ask them, do you want to know what God says? I've never had anybody go, no, I don't want to know. And then tell them what his word says and teach them that God expects us to obey everything he has taught us. I want to say it again. He's not saying just teach the things you understand. He's saying teach everything. Your next point, disciples must learn to obey everything, not part of it. It's not a buffet. You don't get to go through the Bible and go, hey, I like this. Nah, throw that out. I like this. No, throw that out. I don't understand that. We'll forget that one. Jesus says to obey everything. If you will read God's word and if you will ask God, God will answer you. One day I was talking to God, I was reading scripture, and I said, Lord, I'm having trouble swallowing the fact that Jonah was swallowed by a fish. It just kind of, you know. And I said, Lord, you got to help me with this. And this is what he said, that still small voice of the Holy Spirit said, I'm going to prove to you that Jonah's a real person, and it happened just the way it's written. And I said, okay, prove it. And he took me to the text where Jesus says, just as Jonah was 3 days in the belly of the fish, he says, so the Son of Man will be 3 days in the grave, in the tomb, and then he will rise. And that voice said to me, Jesus wouldn't lie, would he? And I had to say, Lord, that is good enough for me. You see, church, God does not get upset if you ask him a question and you say, Lord, I don't understand. Why did you say this? Why did you make it this way? He doesn't get upset with that. You know what he gets upset with? When you say, Lord, you couldn't have meant that, and therefore I'm going to do something different. Pastor Steve and I are talking about a country song. There's a country song out, and it says, you know, God will understand a heart like mine. And I want to write a song that says, no, he doesn't understand. But Pastor Steve said better lyrics would be, he does understand, but it's not what you think it is. That'd be a good country song, wouldn't it? Because she's saying God understands a heart like mine. But she's saying, so therefore what I'm doing is okay. That's not correct. That is not correct. Let's get to some issues now. You have to obey everything I have commanded you. That's what he says. Can we talk about something in our nation today that I think our nation is going to come under judgment for? Let's start with abortion. And folks, we're at a point where it's not even debated anymore. It's the choice of the woman, and it's okay. And I'm here to tell you, it still says in Scripture, thou shalt not kill. Now, if you're in here today and you've ever had anything to do with an abortion, God will forgive you if you repent. But God will not say, hey, it was okay, I've changed what I think. And our nation has gone so far out of whack on this. And if you read Scripture, you will see that when John the Baptist was in the womb of his mother, Elizabeth, and she came into the presence of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and those two babies were in the womb, it says John leapt for joy. Don't tell me he was not a real person, because he was. And Jesus says you have to obey. You have to teach and you have to obey everything I commanded. Not what you like, not what you understand, not what you want to do, but you have to obey everything. You ready for the next one? Adultery and fornication. Our nation is so desensitized to it. Sex outside of marriage means nothing to people anymore. I don't know why, but I guess God wants me to tell the story. I used to buy equipment from a machinery dealer, and this is what he told me. He said, Dave, when my brothers, he had a bunch of brothers, and they all grew up together, and he said, when my brother and I were young, my dad convinced me if I touched a girl on the knee, she'd get pregnant. Now, you're sitting in here going, oh, man, that's a little. But that's how much his dad, who I met and I knew and I respected in my life when I was young, that's how much he wanted to keep his sons holy. And today, it's nothing in the movies. It's nothing in real life for people to go out and to have sex outside of marriage and to commit adultery and think, well, I'll make all kinds of excuses. And how can you look at that in the Scripture and say, well, that's not what Jesus meant and it couldn't be? Hear the Great Commission. He says, teaching them to obey everything I commanded. I'm telling you this today because I want you to really be disciples of Jesus who has all the authority. The next big issue that I see, and there are so many in our nation and in our society, is the whole same-sex marriage and the homosexual issue. Now, listen to me, Christians. You better be on your best behavior. Don't you dare get angry. Don't you be belligerent and don't you belittle. You better love sinners like you've never loved before, but you have to do what we read in the Scripture. You have to stand firm.
I got an email this week that said that if you preach what it says in the Word about homosexuality and same-sex marriage, they're trying to legislate now that they can take away our tax exemption as a church, and that there can actually, you can get arrested. And folks, the only thing real disciples can say to that is what Peter and John said before the Sanhedrin when they said, it's better to obey God than you men. And our nation is in such a difficult place because not recognizing the real ultimate authority of Christ has distorted authority, and therefore they're trying to make legislation and things that go against God. And as a Christian, man, you are going to have to choose one day. And I'm here to tell you this morning, stand firm. Stand firm. I didn't want to end on that, so what about this one? What about greed? Ooh. Every news report has something about money. The money report. And I'm here to tell you today that the Babylonian harlot, she wants everything she can get from you. She wants to own you. She wants you to see the commercial and have to have the new car. And she just wants to grab you and wheel you in. And I'm here to tell you, be content with what you have. Thank God for what you have. I rode my old motorcycle here last night, and a brand new motorcycle came and parked right next to me. And I went outside, and I looked at that, and I started drooling over that thing. And I started going through my mind, what could I tell my wife, you know, in order to get one of these things? And what could I do? And you begin to plot, don't you? And I sat out there and I waited to hear it run, and then I waited to hear it take off. And then I went back to my old motorcycle and I said, I still love you, man. You got to get me home tonight. And you know what? It runs great. The Apostle Paul said, I have learned to be content in whatever state I am in. Come on, church. Live within your means. Take care of business. Don't get caught up in it. It's so powerful. When we hear what Jesus says, he says, teaching them to obey everything. The church has been picking and choosing. And I'm going to say this again. If you don't understand it, it doesn't mean you don't have to believe it. You got to walk by faith, and when you come to God, he'll explain it to you and he'll make sense out of it. Man, when I was young, I thought, oh, come on, what do you mean no sex outside of marriage? You got to be crazy, man. It was, girls are pretty. But I can tell you right now, after I've been married for 38 years, is it awesome? Is it awesome to be in covenant and to keep the covenant and to be faithful and to be able to tell your kids and your grandkids, I was faithful and I stood the test and I obeyed God, and you hand down a legacy that's amazing. And because it's not popular, the churches are like, well, I think I'll just back away from that one. You know, those are tough things. We need to obey everything. So Jesus has all the authority. He says, go into all nations. He says, teach them to obey everything I command. And then listen to this. Always. The one with all the authority is with his disciples always. You see, you can be a witness for Jesus Christ because he never leaves you and he never forsakes you. And you don't have to be afraid, and you don't have to be worried. It says, if they throw you in jail, Jesus said, it won't be you speaking, it'll be the words I give you through my Spirit. You will know what to say to the judge. Can I really get you out there? Maybe the judge will get saved. Come on. The Apostle Paul witnessed to every judge he had, and he told them about Christ. The point is this, he will never leave you. Now, here's what it doesn't say. It doesn't say, I will never leave you, therefore you will never have trouble. It says, I will never leave you, meaning when you go through trouble, don't sit back and go, I hear this all the time. Well, God's not answering my prayer. Yes, he is. He just said no. That's an acceptable answer to everybody except those praying to God, because we say, well, if God answers, then it'll go my way. That is not true. That is not what the Word of God teaches. Jesus said, Father, let this cup pass. His dad said, no. We all benefit from that today. He said, I will never leave you. I will be with you always. So here's how we end this morning. If Jesus has all authority, what are you afraid of? Everywhere you go, you can witness. Go into all nations and then teach them. Teach them. You want to know what will turn our nation around? If our nation comes back to God. It'll turn it around. If it doesn't, it's going to keep on the slide. If you're in here this morning and you've never given your heart to Jesus, if you have never made a commitment and never confessed your sin, never admitted you've sinned, then this morning, don't leave this place without making the commitment. Because if Jesus has all authority, you don't want to meet him not being cleansed from your sin. Come before him this morning. Recognize him as having all authority. Ask him to forgive you. Tell him that you know Jesus died on the cross for you. And Jesus didn't stay on the cross. He rose up from the dead and he has all authority, authority to forgive you. Jesus said to the man lying on the mat, he said, hey, your sins are forgiven. They said, who do you think you are that you can forgive sins? And Jesus said, what's easier to say? Stand up and walk or your sins are forgiven. He said, so that you guys out here will know that the Son of Man has authority to forgive sins here on the earth. He said to the guy, pick up your mat and walk. The guy picked his mat up and walked home. That's pretty cool. He didn't do it just to do a miracle. He did it so you'd know you can be forgiven. If you've never been forgiven this morning, Jesus has all authority and has authority here on earth to forgive your sins, but you have to repent. You have to admit you've sinned. You have to tell him you're sorry. You believe he is who he says he is. Come to the cross and Jesus will forgive you. If you don't know how to do that, please come up here to this altar and talk to me and I will help you before you leave today. If you're in here today and you have been obeying the commands of Jesus, the ones you like or the ones that you understand, it's my prayer today you will repent and you will tell God you're going to obey all his commands. If the world has lured you into thinking that's not what Jesus meant or that's not the way it really is and, you know, it's a cultural thing, throw that away and say, Lord, I want to obey every word you speak. If you're saying to yourself right now, man, that's really a hard thing to do. All I can say to you is this, you're not alone. He said, I'll be with you always. Father, we come to you today. Lord, you know every heart in this place. You know who's following after you. You know who is lukewarm. Lord Jesus, you know each heart. Lord, I pray today that, Lord, you would convict of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. And that, Lord, you would change us today. You would take away fear. And that, Lord, you would send us out to all nations, to all people. And that, Lord, we can be your witnesses. And we can teach them to obey everything that you've said. Revive this nation, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody stay right here. Lord, bless that chili. Lord, watch over our fellowship. Guide and direct us, Lord Jesus. Lord, send us out to be your witnesses. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray for you. If you need time at the altar, take time. If not, go in peace, the love, and serve the Lord. God bless you.